Hello, everyone. My name is Dan Qualiana. I want to thank you for joining us for December's Dev Talk. This month, we are talking about a new card printer Java SDK first up for the first 10 minutes or so. And then we're going to be going into label design and how do you create the most effective labels for your application. Before we dove in, I wanted to give our regular reminder to visit developer.zebra.com, where we're posting news and events for all developer tools and activities we're doing. You can find other events that we are doing on the developer events page. And one of our big announcements, we now have our site live and dates set for the App Forum 2017. You can get access to the page through the developer portal on the Learn More tab. And if we look at the page, you guys can see we have a little information here. You can sign up to be notified once registration opens. If you're interested in sponsoring or speaking at the events, you can also give us information. And we have the dates and locations for the Americas event, which is in Las Vegas on May 9th to 11th. And in Europe, in Prague, from June 14th to 16th. We're also excited to announce we have our keynote speaker, who is Google, and we are partnering with a lot of other industry leaders to try to get some great content this year so we can give a broader perspective of the enterprise software space, not have it only be specific to Zebra. So we really hope to see a lot of you attending there. So thanks again for joining us, and I'm going to turn this over to Crystal Spaeth.
All right. Hello, everyone. Let me just pull this up quick. All right. So I'm going to briefly go over the new Java Card SDK, its purpose, and some of the key features outlining the SDK, and how it kind of compares to the current ones we have for our ZXP card printers. Right now we have two C# SDKs out there, one for the ZXP 1 and 3, and then the Zmotif SDK for the ZXP 7 and 8. One of the purposes of the Java Card SDK is not only to provide a new set of development tools for card printing and encoding, but to support across all ZXP printers. So one SDK, all card printers, which is different from what we have now with those C# SDKs. So that's kind of a big advantage here. Another is that the general installation process is a little less tedious than the current SDKs as well. And I'll explain that a bit more on the next slide. Better library documentation and developer demos. One of the nice things about the new SDK is that since it's in Java, we can use Java Docs for documentation, which is really nicely formatted and provides an easy way to navigate around and get to where you want to go within the documentation. Unfortunately, the documentation for the C# SDKs is kind of embedded into the user manual, so it's not necessarily the easiest or quickest way to read up on the API, but, you know, it works. So that's kind of nice about having the Java Docs available for the API. Some other things to note, the Java Card SDK is supported across different systems running the Java runtime environment. It supports network and USB connection, and in general, providing support for people who use the SDK is going to be a little easier too because of the simpler installation process, and I'll explain that as well. So since the new SDK is completely Java, it's going to be, you know, functional across Windows, Linux, and Mac machines as long as it's running that JRE like I already mentioned. This is nice because users can be flexible with what they develop on. Lots of different platform options as far as IDEs and whatnot, just general Java-related advantages. As far as the actual installation goes, the Java SDK is nice in that everything is all packaged together in one jar file. There aren't separate 32-bit or 64-bit installers, but also there aren't any external library installations either. So no worrying about registering or unregistering any of the DLL libraries, which is something you had to do, especially with the Zmotif, depending on what you were building your application on, be it 32-bit or 64-bit. The new SDK is also driverless, so having to download a driver is one less thing you have to worry about. Being driverless, it's also bidirectional and in capability. So being able to communicate with the printer and get things like the status is really helpful, you know, communicating directly with the printer when you're developing your applications. In general, just having less to worry about when installing everything is really nice. So when you're actually getting any kind of support, there isn't as much time spent figuring out what kind of setup you're running, whether your application is 32, 64-bit, stuff like that. So simplified installation process, we can give you, you know, simplified tech and development support. So a little bit about the actual functionality of the SDK. It provides a lot of methodology similar to that of the C# SDKs, but this one is more like the Zmotif SDK in that it's job-based printing. So what that means is that the SDK receives instructions from an application and builds a job into an XML document, essentially. So that job then gets a unique job ID from the printer, and the SDK can return it to the application. So whenever the application requests the current job status, the SDK can go ahead and pull the printer for that status, whether it's, you know, initializing print, whether it's in progress, finished, or if it, for whatever reason, you know, the job gets canceled. Since the ZXP 1 and 3 printers are command-based, and we're working with a job-based SDK, all that happens then is the job is split into the individual commands that comprise that job to be sent to the printer. So this means that if for whatever reason a command fails, it can report an error code or a status to the application, which is really convenient to, you know, get an idea of what's going on there. But in general, the print job or the XML document describes all the work that's going to be done for a single print. So what happens is it opens a connection to the printer, checks the printer status to make sure that there aren't any issues or anything, and then builds the printable data. So it processes any images, text, barcodes, anything that is going to be on the card, and then sends it to the printer. Goes ahead and tracks it, and then once everything is finished, it closes the connection. So the basic use cases for the SDK are, you know, single or dual side printing, magnetic encoding and reading, a combination of those two, and smart card as well. So I have a little image on the bottom that kind of explains all of that. So the documentation will be live on techdocs.zebra.com soon, but I included the link to where you can find all the LinkOS SDKs here. There is a post on the developer portal about the JavaCard SDK release as well, so we can update that whenever the tech docs for it do become available. Some of the functionality I mentioned on the previous slide do also have developer demos included in the SDK. So I have an example of the printer settings demo, so you can kind of have an idea of what that looks like. So demos as far as graphic conversion, magnetic encoding, color and mono printing, settings, smart card status, the XML template where you upload the XML template and then it shows you a preview of your print before you actually do the printing, which is nice, and multi-job printing. A quick thing to note here is that since the ZXP 1 and 3 don't support multi-job, multi-job won't work on those printers. Just a heads up there. So lastly, a couple things not included in this release of the SDK are general encryption and then smart card encoding over Ethernet, which is something that is included in the Zmotif version of the SDK, but that does required an additional SDK on top of that, but that functionality is not included in this version. So if you'd like to download the JavaCard SDK, I have the link here on the slide. Otherwise, you can go ahead and go to zebra.com and get it from under Software Card Printer Downloads. So thank you. If anyone has any questions, Dan can take over for a minute. Otherwise, I can go ahead and hand it over to Robin.
All right, thanks a lot, Crystal. That was great. Mm-hmm. So if anyone has any questions, please feel free to type those in the box and we can ask Crystal. Also, I failed to mention at the beginning, but we will be placing the presentations as well as a recording on the developer portal. So you'll be able to find those. And we do have a playlist on YouTube for all the previous dev talks. And this one will be added in either late this week or early next week. So Crystal, it looks like no questions so far. So I'm going to pass the ball over to Robin and let her dive into the label creation. I mute Robin.
All right. Thank you, Dan, and thank you, Crystal, for going through the Java Card SDK. What we're going to talk about today a little bit is how to create good, well-designed labels for your applications. The use case for this is anytime you've got an application that you are either redoing and want to update the way that your label that gets printed out of your application is set up and looks, or if you are creating a new application and you need to have some sort of a printed output come out of that to one of the Zebra printers. You know, this is the time where if you don't know a whole lot about printing, which is fairly common, that's where you run into, okay, now what do I do? How do I figure out what I want to actually get printed? If you notice, our SDK is primarily features around the communication side of it. The actual label design and setting up of your printed output is not part of our SDKs, usually speaking. That's something that's an activity that's expected to be done a little bit separately from the SDK. So I'm going to go through exactly how we recommend that you do that. Primarily, it's using the Zebra Designer tool, which is a free tool we've got online, and I'll show you a little bit about that. So the agenda is I'm going to show you how to set up your drivers to work with the Zebra Designer tool to get printed output as a file. Then we're going to use some Zebra Designer and show you how to actually use that tool to create your label. And then we're going to take a look at the printer web page and some of the other tools we've got out there to help you rapidly prototype your labels and get the kind of output that you really want to have for your printers or for the printers that your customers are having. So some software. The Zebra Designer V2 is a free tool we have online on zebra.com that I'll show you how to use today and is a great tool for being able to create a label in a nice, easy GUI that is pretty simple to work with. And the other thing is I'm going to show you some stuff on how to actually use your web browser to do some prototyping. All right, so file printer setup. I'm going to kill the slideshow here real quick and show you how to set that up. Basically, what I'm walking you through here is how to essentially set up a driver to work with the Zebra Designer tool in order so that you can actually get the file of output from Zebra Designer. Normally speaking, Zebra Designer is set up for end users to be able to create labels and print them out on their printers fairly easily. For you guys, you want to actually have a file output so that you can embed it into your application somewhere. So I'm going to show you exactly how to set that up. What we're going to do is we're going to start off by adding a printer, and we're going to add a local printer on here. And we're going to create a new port. There are a couple of different ways to do this. This one is actually my favorite way of doing this because this way I don't have to set up a new file location every time I do a print job. I'm going to set it up so that I have one file location where all my print jobs actually end up going to. Pop this open, and essentially what I need to do is actually find the full and direct path to, I'm going to go onto my desktop here, and copy that over here and give the file a name, out.zpl. You do have to put in a full file path here, and you do have to actually give it a file name in order for this to work. All right, that's fine. Well, let's do it a little bit differently then. Let's give it a different file name then. All right, and then I'm going to pick my Zebra Designer printer. You don't want to use a Zebra printer. These are all card printers. But the Zebra Designer printer. And I find the most generic one to use is the GX series. It's one of our more legacy printers, but it has one of the most, you know, generic outputs, and you can do a couple of different print widths on it. So let's see if I can find it. There's a lot of printers in here. Give me a sec. All right. I'm going to grab a GX420D. Now, you notice in here, some of these drivers have different letters after them. Those have to do with the print languages. One thing you're going to want to note is that if you pick a tabletop or a desktop printer, like the GX420D is a desktop printer, if it does not state a set of letters after the printer name in the driver, that means that it's going to be a ZPL output. If it says EPL after that, it means that the output to the printer is going to be in an EPL mode. The differences are basically, there's a lot of different things that you can do with the different print languages. ZPL is the most common one that we're recommending. I know we've mentioned that before. In the mobile printer lines, if there's no letters after that, the default is actually CPCL. And then you'll get some options for ZPL output as well on the drivers. So generally speaking, I'm going to recommend that you're going to pick a ZPL output driver, which this one is. And we're going to, you can either replace the current driver or use one that's already installed. And I'm not going to make it the default printer because that would just be silly. All right. So once I have my printer set up like that, the other thing that you can do is, say you've already got a printer driver installed in here, you can go into the printer properties and go into the ports here and change your port to be a file port. And that you can set up, basically if you set this up, every time you print, it will ask you what file location you want to save your file to. That's another way to go. I just find it annoying to have to put in a new file name every time I want to actually get a file output. So that's why I leave it actually with the output to file driver like I just showed you. And I'm actually going to... So I went through the steps in here showing you how to do that. I'm going to go past this then and show you how to actually use Zebra Designer. Are there any questions at the moment? Okay. Dan, is there anything up on the board?
No questions right now, Robin.
Okay. What I'm going to do here is I just opened up Zebra Designer. And first thing that comes up here is this new label wizard, this welcome wizard. If you've got labels already in there, it'll show up this. I'm just going to create a new one in here and select finish. And then it's going to pop up this select printer wizard. And I'm going to select the new printer that I just created, the new driver that I just created, or if I already have one set up, which I do, this driver that I set up earlier. And hit next, select stock. We're not going to worry about this at all. We're also not going to worry about the label dimensions. We'll set them from the label dimensions on here. You can do a couple things with rotating the label, orienting the label. So if you go to landscape, it'll kind of show how it'll print out down there. We're going to leave it as the standard in here and give it some dimensions. I'm going to do 3 inches by 2 inches.
we don't want to have any margins in here, just because that actually will, you know, limit how, you know, edge to edge where you can go with your printout. We want to, you know, utilize the full size of the label if we can. And I'm going to hit OK. Now I get my nicely, you know, set up label here that's nice and blank. And I'm going to add a few things to it. So this is just a basic text object, which I can then go in and modify, change where I want it on the page, make the font bigger and smaller just by adjusting the size here. You can also select the fonts. This will have all of the, essentially, the default fonts within the printer listed up here on the font listing. If you do select basically one of the fonts that are in your computer as opposed to in the printer, the output essentially from this tool is going to be an image rather than using the actual in built-in fonts of the printer. So the print quality may or may not be what you're looking for on that, just as a warning, depending on how the font is set up in your computer. So we've got a nice thing there. I'm going to put in a little bit more text. But this time I'm actually going to put in the other text as variable. This is basically a way to set it up so that if, say, you've got a shipping label and you want to, you know, print out a have a shipping label as part of your application. You know, you're doing some shipping in your application. You can set it up so that the address always prints in the same location on your label every time. You never know from one time to the next what that address is going to be, but you know that you always want the address in one area of your label. You always know that you're going to want the, you know, the tracking number in a different area of the label, maybe attached to a barcode and printed somewhere else as well on the label. That's where you get these variable text fields coming in. So on this one, I'm just going to say I've got some variable text. For this particular thing, I'm just going to do is it a keyboard input and give it a prompt, a serial number. And we are not going to put any prefix or suffix in there. So this provides just a basic field here. You can also adjust this one. You can adjust the size of the printed output, what font it's using, and that kind of thing. But this empty basically says it's, you know, it's a variable field. You can add pictures if you like as well. So I see the logo. I want to put that somewhere. I can put it here, but let's make it a little bit smaller. If it's a color picture, this application will actually take the output and will do what we call dithering for it, which basically means it'll take the image and convert it into a true black and white image. So if you remember the old newspapers, that if you look at the photographs on the old newspapers, they were, you know, comprised completely of dots. That's essentially how our printer handles printing images. Is it's comprised with either, you know, black or white, and the dots get printed on the label. So this particular program will actually handle that for you and will give you a dithered output to it. And I'm also going to add a barcode. This one I'm going to have as a variable. There's a number of different types of barcodes that you can have defined in here. Everything from what we call linear, which are, you know, 1D barcodes, your standard UPC codes, and that kind of thing. There's a number of different types of them. And then we also have available 2D barcodes, everything from QR codes to Aztec and data matrix codes. But let's just stick with the code 128. It's a fairly common one, and it handles both alpha and numeric characters to it. And I'm going to make that one variable as well. Going to call this version. So it'll come up here. It'll show red if the whatever your field is outside of the bounds of the box that you label that you've created, and it'll show black once it's in there. And we can also adjust this. Notice how it adjusts in increments. That is actually because the some certain barcodes actually only can be adjusted by increments in the printer. Because of the way that the barcodes are actually set up, that's essentially the way that they work. But I am throwing this on here, fitting it nicely into the label, and now we've got it in there. But to make the output a little cleaner, I'm going to actually delete my image. But that should give us a nice output, and I'm going to save my label here. Name it test. And there's a couple of different options on how to actually get the ZPL output from this. Again, remember this is using the driver, so the output will be ZPL if the driver is set up to be a ZPL driver. It'll come out as CPCL if the driver is a CPCL driver. It'll come out as EPL if the driver is an EPL driver. But first thing you might want to think of doing is hitting print, which gives you a certain type of output. We're going to put in the variable fields here. And you can select this to print a file, and that'll work. But what we're going to do is we're going to use our new driver that we set up. And I'm going to go ahead and print that. And that will have that will have kicked this out to here. So basically, we have at the top here basically some formatting commands, a page width, which is basically most of our printers, not all, but most of our printers are 200 DPI, which means 200 dots per inch. So if the label is 3 inches across, it comes out to 600, but it's not actually 200 dots per inch, it's 203 dots per inch. So 609 is actually exactly 3 inches. and sometimes it'll show the label length in here as well, which would come out to be 206 for 2 inches in length on the label. The output of this is showing, this is our basic text field that we have. Or this line here is actually referring to this variable text field we've got right in the middle of the label. These next two lines are referring to the barcode that we've got at the bottom of the label. And this last line is referring to the Hello World, which is another fixed text that we've got at the top of the label here. And this last one is basically saying print one, you know, print quantity one. We can go into a little bit more detail on that in a minute, but that's your basic setup for the label. And that's wonderful if you're just printing off a label from here, or if most of your text is fixed and you're not worrying about actually having templates and worrying in doing the same kind of output on a regular basis, but you know, with different data all the time. So in order to get the output that is actually a variable, you then actually have to export to printer. And this is actually what will export a template to the printer. If you had this set up with a regular printer driver, not the file output one, when you hit the print button on this list, it will actually print off the label. When you hit the export to printer, it will not print anything. It will just send the template to the printer and save it on the printer. So we're going to do that. We're going to save it to the printer. There's a couple of different options as to where to save it. Pretty much you're going to always want to select internal flash on here. And that then updates my output. And there's a couple of differences here now on this page. It lists the file name that I originally saved this this label file for. If your file name is greater than 8 characters, it will truncate it down, but it'll basically put in the file name that you gave your label. And this line here actually is basically telling the printer to store this as a stored format. Then instead of having the data that I put in there, it'll put in the serial number and the version, just like I put in into the label as my variable field name. So the nice thing about this is that When you've stored it in the printer and you're using our SDK, you can actually recall this format using our SDK and create a form where you don't even have to necessarily know the names of the fields. In your form, you can actually just call out the names of the fields from the format directly using our SDK. We've got a couple of different sample codes showing this, including the PrintStation demo in the Android code base, and in the Xamarin code base, we've got one of the demo apps shows how to pull stored formats from the printer and create a form using these fields in the printer. And that gives you some ideas on how to actually utilize this. You can also just call it out by field numbers if you want to, and fill in the data as you go through and want to do your printing. All right, are there any questions so far?
Yes, we do have a few questions, Robin. One question that came in was, how can I set a variable strikeout text? Do I need to use a special font for that? So that's text that would have the line through it.
That is a very good question. In a stored format, I don't know that there's a way to do that in a stored format now that I think about it. The way that, generally speaking, you can do it is when you are recalling your format, you can add fields. So you can add your strikeout or not in your code as you're adding the as you're recalling the format that's stored on the printer or stored as part of your application. So basically, you'd have to do it in your code in order to get something like a variable strikeout. Now, if you have text fields or barcode fields and you want to either show or not show them, that is fairly simple. If you don't put any data in or don't recall that particular field. So say I have this label and this is my serial number field right here. If I don't actually recall this field number 11 or the serial field, it won't print anything there. So it'll basically leave that particular thing empty. If I simply tried to print this particular label without putting in any fields, it will just print Hello World at the top. It will not print out anything below that on this label because both of these other fields are variable. Does that make sense?
Yes. Thank you. So we have another question on fonts. So you have your label, your ZPL template there, and the question is, what would the ZPL look like if you selected a Windows font such as Calibri?
Yeah, so let me pull this up and I'll show you. Basically, the way it works is that the driver and this application will convert that text area into a image. So let me pull up let's do this one. I'm going to So it's actually converting this into an image that's named Test 1000 GRF, and this is all the image content for that. And then when it goes ahead and stores the label, it has that as part of the stored format for the label. Does that make sense?
Yes. What if, is there an alternate way of doing it through Zebra Designer if they wanted to store the font on the printer? So they would have to get a license for the font, put that on the printer, and then use that font for the text? Or is that not something we can do through Zebra Designer? That's more if you're just writing your own ZPL.
Well, it's not something you can do through Zebra Designer. You can store a new font on the printer using the there's a couple of different ways of actually storing fonts on the printer. There's the font downloader that comes as part of the Zebra Setup Utilities package. It looks like this. We also have another font downloader that is part of the Zebra Link Zebra NetBridge package. So there's a couple of different ways of doing that. Basically, what I would recommend in that case is to use the, you know, one of the, in when you're creating your label, use one of the Zebra fonts, like Font Zero, which is probably the most scalable and most easy to work with. Use one of those fonts, and then when you get your output, it'll kind of look like this. And there's a command to tell it, basically the font that is that we're talking about is listed right here after the A. So there's a couple of things you can do to then tell it instead to use your font that you've loaded into the printer. You can either give it another font number like zero, but basically tell the printer, there's a command to tell the printer, it's one of the C commands, and I forget exactly which one. Tell the printer which font to use that way, or you can do A at, do an A at symbol, and then after here, you put in your font.
So that, Robin, actually leads in really well to another question, which was, is there a user guide that shows all the ZPL commands?
Yeah,
like
there
PW
definitely is.
With? Okay.
And I'm going to show you how to get to it from Launchpad, because that I find is actually one of the easiest ways to do it. So if you're on Launchpad and you go to the printing section, you can, well, actually, there's a couple of different ways to do it from Launchpad. So you go on here to API references. Under printing, there's a CBCL programming guide and a ZPL programming guide. So that'll pull you up to the full programming guide with all the ZPL commands in it. It is a very long document, I will warn you. But say the command I was just talking about, the C command to change the font defaults. So basically, this is a way to basically set a character as your, you know, as the font that you want to use. So you basically set it up as one of the characters, give it some heights and widths, and that defaults it. And that's not exactly the one I was looking for. anyway, let me pull this back up to the page. There was another command. CW. So basically, this is a way to give a letter to a font, and then you basically tell it the location of that font, and then every time you use that letter as the font designation, it will print off the font that you downloaded, as opposed to the, you know, a font that's in there, or, you know, if there's no font that lists under that label, under that letter or character. I generally will recommend you're going to use the A through Z letters to designate your fonts. 0 through 9 is a lot of the default fonts are using those. So it's up to you, but you can either do it this way or you can use the A at command to specify the font that you want for any individual fields. There's also a command in here to set the default font for the entire label so that you only have to set the font once. But that means that if you want to have things of different sizes and, you know, different types of fonts going on, then, you know, you have to modify that each line as well. So does that
Yeah, that was
answer
great.
That question?
Thank you, Robin. So we actually have three more questions. Was there more you wanted to cover and we can come back to them, or do you want me to go through the other questions?
Let's go back to them. There are a couple of more things that I wanted to show everybody. Once you have your label designed, the next thing to do is actually to do some testing with it. Now, you can use Zebra Designer and use one of the standard drivers for whatever printer you've got hooked in to do that. There's also a tool that we have, Zebra Setup Utilities, that allows you to do some fun things with the printer. Basically, I'm going to select the printer that I actually have here, which, sorry, I've got so many printers. I think this is one. All right, what I'm doing right now is, because I've got so many of these printers on here, I am trying to figure out which printer is actually the one that I've got connected over USB right now. The way I'm doing that is I'm clicking this, selecting the printer driver and clicking open communication with printer. And if it wasn't the printer that is actually connected, it says unable to open port here at the bottom. Thankfully, I did this time actually pick the right one. So this is the printer that's currently connected to my computer, and I can do certain things that are bidirectional communication to the printer. So I say hi to the printer, and it responds back telling me what type of printer it is, its firmware version. This 8 is saying what basically the whether or not it's 200 dpi, 300 dpi. Basically, it's 8 dots per millimeter. Is what this is telling me, and then how much free storage space is left on that printer. So there's a bunch of different things, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my output here that I got from Zebra Designer and put that in there. I am also going to, because this is just going to store the format on the printer, nothing's actually going to happen. It'll basically save it on there, and you won't, anything other than if I then go in and request a listing of the files on the printer. That's what this particular thing is. And it's going to give me a nice file listing, and there's my test.zpl file right there. And now I'm going to go in and attempt to print my label. And like I said before, all it's printing is hello world at the top because I didn't actually put in any of the variable text. So that's wonderful. You get a lot of a lot of things you can do with this particular tool. You can also, go in and configure a bunch of the printer settings, connectivity settings, and the setup utilities is a great tool. We've got it's free as well. But using this open communication is one of the ways we recommend to do that communication. And that's all well and good, but it means that you're wasting a lot of paper every time you actually want to make an adjustment to this ZPL as you go through and do things. Say I want to actually make this a little bit more solid and change this out to 400 and change this out to 250 because I just don't like the way it looks when I'm doing this. This is basically the location of that text field on the page. If I make these adjustments, okay, then I got to go ahead and print it out again. Well, there's a way around that, and it's something we call print previewing. It only works with networked printers, but it's a great little tool. So right now I've also got my printer here networked, and I'll show you how to use that particular tool. No, we're not going to save those. So up here, I'm going to put in my IP address of my printer. And index.html. And this gives us what we call a printer web page. It'll tell you the current status of the printer. If I pop the print head on the printer, it should adjust and tell me that head is open. Close that up again. And it goes away. There's a couple of different things. You can view the printer configuration, which is great. It tells you a lot of the different settings. You can even modify a lot of the printer settings. The default password on all of our printers is 1234. And that's not really a hidden thing. We don't hide it. I do recommend that you change the password on yours. And there is a ZPL command to do that. But basically, it'll give you some access to updating the settings from this web page and doing a few things like that. So there's a bunch of different settings that you can actually configure and set up using the web page, but that's not what we're really here for. We're here more for the print preview, and that you get to through the directory listing. So say I've got, the bunch of files on here, which I do, but if I don't, that's not a big deal. I can go in here and create a new script, and I'm going to give it a file name. and edit that. So now I got a nice little box here. What do I do with this? All right, this is where we go back to our output here. And I'm actually going to modify this a little bit with ZBrew Designer, and I'm actually going to do the file output. If you try to send this as the test, it doesn't really like it that much because it's a download format, not an actual printout. So what I'm going to do here is I'm actually going to do my printed output. And that gives us this particular file. And I'm going to go back to my web page. Copy this out and put it into the text box here. So I know what it prints off on, you know, what it prints off, but it doesn't, you know, this will actually give me a way to, if you put it down here, preview label, it'll actually show what will print off on the printer. And I don't know if there's a way to adjust this. Yeah, hard to see it in here, but basically it'll give you a way to see what's actually going to print off on your printer. And you can actually save this as a file. And it shows it like this. Now the reason why it shows it like this is because right now my printer is calibrated to be like 6 inches long. And I didn't do anything to adjust that to make it see that the label output was only 2 inches. And I'll kind of show you what I mean by that.
So Robin, I'd like to just interject here to say that even this mistake, or you know, quote unquote mistake that's shown, it kind of emphasizes the value of this tool in that the printer is rendering the image, so you're seeing the exact output that you would see. There are a few online tools that other folks have created that kind of give a general guideline of what a label would look like based on the ZPL, but there are gaps in the implementation on those, and it's not tied in exactly with your printer. So that's really the big strength of using this method Robin is showing here.
Yeah, thanks, Dan. The big thing here is that the printer is actually fully rendering this exactly how it would render it as it was printing. So the output you're getting here is essentially exactly what the printer will print if it was given this as a print job, which is a great benefit. So say, you know, I see that this is off to the side, or if I created a label, obviously, the label that I created was a 2x3-inch label, and my printer was actually set up to only do 2-inch wide printouts, then this would actually show the fact that it would be cut off. So I'm going to copy my stuff in here again. But this time I'm actually going to set a label length of 2 inches. That's what the 406 is. And say I wanted to actually make the adjustment to the barcode, which I can do here. Let's see if that actually works. Let's see where that goes with it. And then I preview it. And all right, it shows the barcode's even pushed over to the side more. So I adjusted it in the wrong direction. But at least now I can see it on the screen. And I know that I didn't have to print it off and waste that paper each time I did it. So I'm actually going to adjust it back the other way then. Let's go down to 400 for where I put that. Preview it. And now it actually seems to be a little bit more centered, although it might be a little bit too far over. So this is a way that you can actually rapidly go through and adjust things on your label and you know, figure out what you're doing before actually wasting all the paper as you're going through and printing these off. Because normally the way to do this would be to print off a label every time, and you know, that way you're wasting a lot of that media. And this way it is actually showing you exactly what the printer will render it as. Okay, got the end of my spiel there. Are there any questions I can answer?
Yeah, we have a few, Robin. So one tied in specifically with the web page here. One of the people in the audience said that they have a QLN 220 and the web page they see is different. So they're not seeing the same options there. So which printers have the exact same web page that you are displaying there? Or do you know if there are some exceptions like the QLN?
Well, each of the printers has some slight differences on it. If you just put in the IP address of the printer, this is essentially the web page you're going to get. I'm hoping this is what he's seeing on his QLN 220 and is having the problem with. The way to get to the printer page that I'm talking about is you actually have to add the index.html in order to get to this web page. That'll give you the adjustments that you need. Some of the older, especially like tabletop and desktop printers, you can just put in the IP address and you'll get to this page. There are certainly some of the older models where you can see the actual web page of the print server as opposed to the printer, and there's a few things you have to do to get to the printer web page. So there are some adjustments and some differences between the different printers and how they work. Most of the common ones that we've got out now, you do have to add the index.html in order to get to the correct web page that gives you this directory listing, which is how we got into there. Does that answer the question?
That's great, Robin. Thank you. So let's see. We had a couple questions on templates. One of them was you showed how to send the template to one printer that you are working through Zebra Designer. If you want to send the template to a lot of printers that are already deployed at a site, how would you go about doing that? And is that something you would use Zebra Designer for?
Zebra Designer does have a version, it's a pay-for version called Zebra Designer Pro, where you can do deployment out to multiple printers using essentially a spreadsheet or a database, and you can, fill in the database information. I believe, and I actually could be wrong on this, you can deploy it out to multiple printers. That's not really what Zebra Designer is designed for. If you need to deploy the same file out to a bunch of printers, that's where you get into more of the device management type of tool sets. If you're using some of the older products, that's where the ZebraLink NetBridge application comes into play. This application allows you to find and connect to a bunch of network printers and basically add file resources and other types of resources to the printers and roll them out that way. We also have a lot of newer device management tools that come along with some of the with LinkOS product line. Things like you can actually do template loading to multiple printers with SODI or AirWatch. We have a program we call Profile Manager, or you can actually have a basic server app to do that as well. If you wanted to create your own way of rolling out this stuff, there's Mirror. That comes on a lot of the products right now. Basically, you set up an FTP site and you set up the printer to call out to that FTP site when it turns on and pull down files. Could be anything from firmware to templates like this. There's a number of different ways to roll it out. I would not recommend Zebra Designer as the way to do that.
Great. So the other one we had around kind of templates and using variables. You showed us how we could do a variable information in a barcode or text. What about images? Is there a way to do variable images?
Yeah, this is a question we get fairly frequently. The way that I recommend doing variable images is in the designer here. What I would recommend is if your image is, say, something like a signature, and it's always going to have the same, essentially, the same size on the page. So if this was my signature, and it's not, but say this was my signature, and I always knew that it was going to be in a certain area of my label or a certain area of my page, I would essentially create a a file that shows us. Now, the easiest way to do this on an Android device is if you've got a signature capture window, you can, you know, store that as a bitmap file, generally speaking, on Android. And then you can actually pull that bitmap file off, save it on your computer, and then use that in here as a baseline, as your template portion of it. Just do a basic, you know, signature and use that as part of your template. Now, it's not going to be the same every time you want to print it, but this is just the way to get your variable one, is to use a, you know, generic one that you've got as a template for this, for the template design. So say I've got my image in here, and I'm gonna go ahead and export that. Okay. All right, so in my exported file, I have this image that I just added to it. This is the zebra image that I put on there. You can actually go ahead and delete that if you want. But in here, it does recall an image with a specific name. So once you go back to your app and you're, say, saving a signature, you're not going to want to keep, you know, every copy of the signature around in your app, I don't think. You know, if you do, you're going to want to sit, you know, put it back up to your server. You're not going to want to store it in the app. So if you save that image under the same name every time in your application, and then you basically, before you do the printout of this, you send that image to the printer under the same file name, it'll overwrite the image file in the printer every time. So that's your way of, I guess, if I'm making sense here, I'm not sure. But basically, you would overwrite the file name in the printer every time you had a signature file. As long as you kept the size of the file the same every time, then it'll print off in the same place on your label every time with whatever the variable information is. I'm hoping I'm making sense.
It made sense to me. I think if there's any other questions around that one, you know, please let us know. But I think that definitely makes sense, Robin.
Yeah, I believe we do have a Android sample code that shows how to do this as well in the knowledge base.
Excellent. Well, Robin, those were all the questions that we had. So do you have any kind of closing thoughts?
Now, there are a number of different ways to handle this, and if you want to learn a little bit more about ZPL and how to manage it and make adjustments to it like I was doing in the call, I do recommend that you go to the programming guide, and there is a section in here, actually just pull it up, called Basic ZPL Exercises. And this is basically a little tutorial, a way for you to walk through and learn how to use ZPL. I highly recommend it. When I first started here, this was basically they, you know, threw the manual on my desk and, you know, set a printer next to me and said, go at it. And, you know, this is how I learned ZPL. So I definitely recommend it as a way for you to, you know, learn a little bit about it, learn how to use it, and learn some of the quirks and tricks for utilizing ZPL. So there's a bunch of different exercises in here you can run through. And I think it's a good exercise to, you know, learn how to make those adjustments yourself if you like.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Robin. That was a great overview of label design and how to deploy that to the printer. Crystal, I also want to thank you for the information on the Card Java SDK. And thank you to all the attendees who joined in. As a reminder, we will have the slides that we're going through posted to the original post about this dev talk, and we will have the recording posted to YouTube in the next few days. And also, for any past events or sessions, you can find those on YouTube and on the developer portal. And one last reminder, that app forum, we'd love to see all of you there, so please go to zebra.com/appforum, or you can get to the link off of the banner on the developer portal. So thanks again to everyone for attending, and Robin and Crystal for the presentations.